We apologize about that mishap in the transmission. We were experiencing a technical hitch, but good enough. We are back and we go on with the news review. Mheshimiwa Johnson Sakaja, you are on the floor.
Can I be
we're suspecting him.
Because I was trying to address Mweke.
You had actually said, I disagree with.
Nakambia kazi wazima. But anyway, I think what I'm also here is not because unfortunately for the viewers, we went on with the discussion.
Yeah.
I was just raising the kind of biases we've seen in the polling. And I was just giving him some examples in Nairobi in areas which are, you know, clearly known to be either pro-NASA or pro-Jubilee, and the polling is done differently. And of course in the discussion we said it depends on how you sample. If you're doing the face-to-face sampling,
yeah.
If you go to a certain area at a certain time, you'd only find a certain demographic. You know, but I think moving forward, what we should be more concerned about is the mood that we're setting the country.
Yeah.
The expectations we're putting to the people before an election that has not been decided.
Yeah.
Because people will still have to go to the polling stations and vote. And people can change their mind. You know,
and Kenyans like have a very big problem. We have a very big problem called perception.
Mm.
Yeah.
If the pollsters make me generate a perception that my candidate is winning, I will not take anything less when the results are announced. But away from that, ladies and gentlemen, what's your take about this high percentage, genuine or not, of the undecided vote? We have just about 14 days. According to Ipsos, 5% of Kenyans are undecided. According to Infotrack, 8%. Is this number okay? Is it too high?
Well, it just means that those who are being polled, when they are asked who are you going to vote for, they say they didn't know yet. 2 weeks to the election, it's unlikely. I agree with Mheshimiwa Sakaja. That percentage is a little too high.
Mm.
Although in some instances, because of the, again, our culture, you'd never want to be an outlier. We've even seen in some instances when you're standing in line as you're going to vote, people are asking each other, tunavotia nani, tunavotia nani.
Yeah.
Yeah? And it's either that they're trying to show they're part of you and they're going to listen to you while they know in their heart
they have met with
who they're going to vote for.
Yeah.
So it's really just a show. Yeah. So I think that undecided is something that you should not look at very seriously. It can give you an indication on an indication that you might need to do a little more campaigns. Like for me as a politician, it tells me, listen, there's still some people out there in Nairobi who don't know who they are voting for. Can I find out who these people are and swing them on my side? But it's highly unlikely that 14 days to the election people
close
don't know who they are voting for.
Well, I'll say that the undecided, and I think it will be very difficult for anyone, especially, let me give an example of Nairobi. People wake up very early in the morning and they go to work, and they'll come back late at night, especially in the areas where they go to industries.
Mm.
Therefore, none of these opinion pollers have been able to even ask them who they are voting for. And I'll say as Weke, those are the guys who come, maybe they know who the presidential candidates are, but you'll find them now asking who is the MCA now, because they have not been there, they have not been in any of those campaigns. So it's not undecided, it's only that most of them, there are so many candidates, you don't know the names, but you only know who? The presidential candidates and maybe the governors, period.
Quite interesting.
You know, I think again it's really how the question is asked and within what context. Even in these face-to-face interviews, you need to know if it's just one person isolated from a crowd who is asked the question when the rest are not, you know, within earshot. Because I'll give you an example. During the nomination for Jubilee, when I was voting, I voted here in the Greater North, and this is my candidate, I'm voting for her.
You are high employer.
And she's voting for me as well. But when I was going to vote for in the nomination, there were two MCA candidates for Kilimani behind me, and they all expected me to vote for them. So when they would ask, two of them were there. So when they were sure, I was really going to hide my ballot because they were right behind me, and all these cameras of media when I was going to cast my ballot. I think people would not like sometimes to say who they are voting for. But again, I reiterate my point. I think a huge majority of Kenyans have an idea who they are voting for if elections are held today. And whether it can change or not, you know, of course, I mean, something drastic, radical can happen. you know, that makes you change your mind. You know, Raila might do something crazy, or Uhuru Kenyatta might do something crazy, and makes you, you know,
completely change even, your,
You know, and to some extent, I agree with what Mweke said about Kiambu, because there was some propaganda that came out very close to the election about some comments that were made, and several comments towards women, and I don't think they were true. But you know, in politics,
so you
only fair in love and war.
You agree with him that one day in Kenya's politics can change.
Yeah, can change, but not to 74%. You know,
it can change to 100%.
I don't think there's anything Winston Raila Odinga can do that makes him go down to 10%, or Uhuru Kenyatta can do that can make him go down there. And many of these things you're saying are decided. Some people, unfortunately, will just go and say, "What is the party? Let me vote."
Mm-hmm.
And Nairobi now they keep telling us, you guys are telling us six piece, as we're doing zigzag.
Zigzag.
So what is this zigzag?
Zigzag is the cause.
Nasema wanajua kuchaguana. Let me tell you, this undecided voters is actually real. It's a real concept. And let me tell you why. Kenyans actually love this season. It's a beautiful season for them. You can see that if you go to one ground, it's red. When you come back, it's blue. Or it's orange. It's not that the people have come in from another region. People. It's the same people. So this is
actually told in the rural areas, people have lots and lots of t-shirts.
Oh my
God. When Sakaja and are coming, I wear red. When you are coming, I wear blue.
Yeah. Let me just use Makueni as an example. When the Jubilee Brigade come to Makueni, you will be told it's a predominantly NASA region, but their meetings are full. Absolutely red
t-shirts.
Red t-shirts. But when I go back there after a day, they have no t-shirts. They have disappeared. So the public are really enjoying this season, whereas they don't want to make a decision a little too early, because then Sakaja will not entertain them. So it's a real thing. This decision, if you are to do this polling, and that is why there's a cap. People are not aware that there's a cap. That this, you will not do this 7 days to polling.
But isn't it? Isn't
7 days to polling? Because 7 days to polling, or 2 days to polling, or a day to polling. I remember in 2007 some propaganda that came out about Mheshimiwa Kalonzo Musyoka during his presidential election that actually changed the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Just on the bill itself, negatively, positively, negatively, that he had agreed to work with Mwai Kibaki. So he changed the polling. And he lost substantially a number of votes, because people thought, oh my goodness, why waste your vote? So they say, why waste your vote? And he has agreed to work. Mm-hmm. So that is something that you, all of you, must agree that there's a substantial portion of Kenyans who are still sitting and asking one another on WhatsApp, who are we going to vote for? Based on many
I wonder whether you would categorize that as undecided or uncommitted.
That's what I wanted to ask. It's the same people who are fence sitting.
Yes.
It's just because they haven't decided.
And I'll agree with them.
They are uncommitted.
They are not committed at all. They don't want to commit.
I want to agree.
But in their hearts and hearts,
in their hearts,
no.
They are
not committing.
On Saturday, I was at Kilimani. And we had a community dialogue on many issues. And after that, the lady asked me, are you the same Elachi you go on media? Because on media you look so different. You are so fierce. But today I've seen a very different Elachi. By the way, you have changed my vote. I have to give you. I said, what do you mean? So they're there, and you can see, this is a middle class person.
So when you come here, don't be so fierce.
No. It is the way we speak. They'll say my Duke is fierce because of, you know, it's how the perception, what you just talk about, how Kenyans just look at you and decide you are just a very serious Jubilee person, which is not right, because we are here for all Kenyans. Mm-hmm. That we don't look at our parties, we look at the issues.
We inform.
Yeah.
Indy, you're saying something before we move on to the headlines.
No, I was just going to ask Senator Junior. Are those really undecided voters, or those are voters having fun? Those are entrepreneurs.
Let me tell you, you might not agree, but this is a season that Kenyans love.
I tell you, and they are praying it to continue.
Because it pleases them. You know, this is the time you're talking to them.
Let's move on. The season that Kenyans love, according to Senator Mutula Kilonzo Jr., is supposed to end in about 2 weeks. However, 10 burning issues 2 weeks to the polls are still glaring. Now, the Standard isolates the issue of Standoff of tallying by parties. NASA's reported servers abroad. The timeline for IABC to announce presidential results. Further detail on page 8. It says the issues that need fixing before August 8th. The election backup system, that's the standard. Parallel vote tallying system that NASA plans to set up in Tanzania. Adopt a polling station pushed by the opposition to protect votes. Lack of proper civic education for voters. Publication of register of voters for every polling station. How soon to announce the presidential results. Training of poll officials. Delivery of ballot papers. The presidential debate. And the fear of post-election violence.
Presidential debate is not an issue.
Lots of issues, but very important issues.
Are these issues?
They are. Security issues, tallying of results, how long you will take to announce results, are extremely fundamental to the election. People are not, and something like the testing. You see, people are talking, and I had a comment by Masharia Gaiva, by the way, recently, that people are talking about a peaceful election, and forgetting that they should be talking about a credible election, because it's a credible election that leads
that
to
brings peace. Yeah.
That brings peace. So, what is the level of confidence that Kenyans have? Mm-hmm. Somebody says that they want election results announced within 7 hours.
Within 7 hours after the last poll.
Within 7 hours, Kenyans still do not know today. That courtesy of the select committee where I sat with Elachi, you have an integrated system. You have a gadget that has got satellite network, it has got Safaricom network, it has got Airtel network. Your form will be scanned and sent. The setting up of a portal where if I want a result in Dagoretti South, if I'm in Makueni, it ought to be available. I ought to be able to retrieve it.
From the IABC.
IABC portal. Those are the online. Things that the online portal that they should be talking about. The question of tallying. I mean, we sat here and the lights went off. People are wondering, is the same going to happen in Bomas? Mm. What kind of backup do we have? We have proposed that you're going to have 3-4 servers in alternative locations. Mm. We had proposed that we even have offsite servers for purposes of IABC and generators and everything. Nobody's talking about those things.
Those are proposals. Were they actualized?
They have done it, but they are not talking about it.
I think the problem we have is Mutula and Lalachi and their colleagues who are in that thing. Possibly the chicken wings are really, confusing people, because the work that they did needed an extended oversight and communication to the people after they had done it. Mm. A lot of these questions you're asking, and when you say tell issues, I think the biggest issue we have is the media, because you're about creating these issues.
Yeah.
A lot of these things are in the law.
Yes.
A lot of these things are able to be found from the IBC, from members who are in that committee.
Yes.
But if we start talking about non-issues and making them big.
Whose mandate is it to tell people what's in the law? As far as the elections are concerned.
The media informs.
It's actually IBC
that will
communicate.
But you see, when you say 10 burning issues, that alone is an alarming headline. 10 burning issues. Two weeks to the phone, and you look at them, the things, I mean, at the party is doing their tallying. Of course, I will do my tallying as senator.
Yeah.
I will do my own tallying. I need to know the results coming in.
So there is absolutely nothing wrong with parties doing their tallying.
Everybody is doing their tallying.
Do it in Kazakhstan.
Yeah. In fact, I'm looking for nice words for TV.
Yeah.
You better do.
Better than clever candidate who
will not
tell the agents as soon as the result comes on the polling
station.
Take a picture, send it to my campaign headquarters for me to also do my tallying.
Mm.
So that when it changes, I know there's a problem.
But listen to this, Mheshimiwa Sakaja, before I get to hear from the other two panelists. One of the things that they talk about here on page 8 is fear of post-election violence. Now, on page 5 of the standard, the police top officers are warning that failure of electronic equipment on the election day could pose a major threat to security.
It is. I think it's because of the tone we're setting.
Mm.
You know, you tell someone...
So should the police want to the tone?
They should not. And that's a very responsible statement. When you look at these are the burning issues, today people are discussing what they are burning issues. Now, these are the things that... You know, we're setting them up to create this... But let me tell you, this is the one election. And I've gone across the country. This is the one election that is more calm than any election we've had before. My friend here, Jonathan Mweke, vied for governor, deputy governor in 2013. this number of days to the election, was the temperature the same?
Yeah.
It was much higher in 2013.
It was high.
This election is actually the most, the temperatures are not as high. But it seems like there are people who want us.
Who really want that to be high.
I to say this.
Which is here is accusing the media.
I'm not accusing. I'm just saying the media should also be in the same tone as the country. But if you set an agenda where you always have an issue and yet you have not done research, because just the way Mutula said, and 2 weeks ago I said the same thing again, that it is important to understand there is even a committee in the, which works close with IBC from both sides,
all parties
yes, that sit down and say technology. Yes, we've reached
on
here
technology
on the technology part. Yeah. We have reached here, yeah. Yes, we have agreed. Let's move. That's how IBC has been moving.
How is the common voter supposed to know that?
Listen, honestly, it was you who and that's why I'm saying, I pray to God now our media to have a research center where any issue, current issues that are coming up, you just go to the institution that is there, ask them, as you bring out this, they will show you all these things are there.
You know, one of the policies.
One thing the media has not even told Kenyans.
One of the policies in the media is we rely on official institutions. The official institution entitled to take care of security is the police. But now the police are saying if the electronic system fails.
Let me go to the police. The police are saying that because number one, the first people to be banned will be the police. So let us not even go there, because already we have sought a tone also on them, and we are saying, first of all, we are saying, if they don't take care of this, we will do this. And that the police have suffered also. Kenyans who are policemen and policewomen have suffered in the same. Because who will when we start setting an agenda and saying, the opposition are saying we shall ensure our supporters remain at the polling station. It's because of lack of information to our people that, first of all, each stream, the highest number that will be in a stream is only 700.
And the opposition is not the media.
The highest. Right?
The opposition is not the media.
No, it's not media.
The media just carries what the opposition has said.
Good.
So the opposition, where Mutula Kilonzo Jr. and Beatrice Elachi are, or I mean the government and the opposition, why don't you go to those rallies and say, these systems will not fail because we have a committee working with IEBC and we've done ABCD.
But at the same time,
you spend more time.
We don't spend more time. In fact, more time. Look at your headline here. Uhuru will create 6.5 million jobs. Raila, we have alerted EU and AU. EU media. How do you put that headline?
So
already the perception, what we said, Kenyans with their perception say, oh, so our former prime minister is just interested on this. What is he giving? You know, let us sit and ask ourselves, 1 week, 2 weeks to the election. Are we all on the same level that we want a credible and peaceful election? If we want credible, the media will come out and say, five burning issues, but five issues that are already set, and we are now advising Kenyans. This is set for us,
Jonathan,
to see a credible election.
You know, with all due respect to the media, those 10 burning issues that you have spoken about is issues that are questions that have been asked by stakeholders, either the citizens, the election observers, the opposition, and so on and so forth. Yeah, the civil societies, those are questions that are being asked. What brings suspicion and raises up the tension is when those questions are not answered.
Yes.
So what I'd expect to happen here, it's good that the media has highlighted this question so that you don't sweep them under the carpet. Because it means somebody is asking these questions. Somebody is asking, listen, we are hearing the opposition saying they're going to have tallying. We are hearing the government saying that you cannot tally. What is the real position? IBC should come out and say that anybody can tally their own results. You're just not allowed to announce.
Kaja is on the platform, we will say, inafikia opposition wanaenda kutali Tanzania.
Yeah.
I mean, what signal does that send to the public?
So I think what needs to happen is, and that's why we keep saying transparent. That's the meaning of transparent, when we ask about transparent. These institutions, and out of all those questions, I think it's only one that the National Police Service or the security agencies should be replying to, post-election violence. Everything else, IBC should come out and say, listen, this is the position on tallying. This is the position on agents.
Yeah.
You're being told that agents on polling stations. This is for position of so and so. I mean, Parliament Joint Committee should come out and say we took care of all these issues of backups and everything. That we inform the public.
Listen,
that's a challenge to the two of you.
No, we did.
No, no, no.
Have you called a press conference?
No.
Our committee was disbanded. We come front as official.
No, yeah.
Let me tell you what the media should be highlighting, and even the police appear to be sending false alarms. Unlike 2013, where we had 34,000 BVRs and 15,000 EVIDs that were unmatching the polling station, IBC says there are 44,000 integrated management system. The question is, out of 44,000, how many have been tested? Mm-hmm. How many have backup? What is the backup battery lifespan of? How many will be available in the event? Out of 44,000.
So those are the issues.
Mm-hmm. You're framing the wrong issues. What? Mm. How many do we have to back up one polling station in Makueni in the event it fails?
Yeah.
How many batteries are available in the event it fails? Mm. How many will you transmit if you're in Kajiado Central, where you do not have network at all?
Do you people have a role as politicians
to do
in the narrative that is sent?
Yes. And let me finish. When you highlight Matiang'i talking about polling stations so many times, yet that is not his role.
Mm-hmm.
The person who should be addressing the question of how many people will enter the polling station
is
IEBC.
It's actually our next discussion once we
but you highlight him so many times instead of asking the question. This is not a security issue per se at the first instance. It's not his business. It is IEBC to say out of this number of parties, okay, will allow several agents to come into the polling station. What will be the role of each agent? What will they be checking? That is what they should do. For the question of security, how many people will be allowed within the periphery of the polling station, in and out of the school?
My question, Mheshimiwa Sakaja, mm-hmm, are these the issues that the stakeholders, the voter, wants to know?
No, I don't think so. I think there could be issues, and just like Senator Mutula said, but these are not the issues.
No.
You know, and a communication expert will tell you, when you use certain trigger words, you make a headline alarmist, like burning, you know, 10
burning issues.
Then you know, just let's look at these issues. Standoff of Watalin by parties. Is that standoff? He's a leader in Wiper.
Yeah.
Where leaders in Jubilee, I don't see any.
There's
no standoff.
There's no standoff.
NASA was reported travels abroad, as I said. They can have them in Kazakhstan if they want.
Yeah.
There's nothing. In fact, let me tell you. People have cloud servers on the cloud. Which country is the cloud?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
when you find your ear down,
you cannot. It's the cloud. So whether it is in Dar es Salaam, whether it is in Kazakhstan, it doesn't matter. Time meant for BC to announce presidential results. Uh-huh. This is provided for in the law.
Yes.
Actually, the court in Kisumu, the High Court in Kisumu, is making a ruling on that today. So
because you cannot say that you must do it in 7 hours, because there's counting that is going on. You know, you cannot predetermine the length of time. You don't know the turnout.
The same way we cannot discuss that issue because, of course, it's in the court in a way that will.
It's only sub judice if our discussion can affect the outcome. I don't know if
the case has already been heard.
I don't know if the judge is
waiting for a ruling. He's not listening to us.
The judge is not listening. I think that needs to be done. And I am personally, as an individual, extremely disappointed with the IEBC. Because the IEBC knows that there has been a confidence crisis.
Yeah.
If I was the chairman of the IBC, I would have a daily briefing.
Yeah,
I would have said, address all these issues daily, one by one, exhausted. Read, speak as if you're reading from the Bible.
Yeah.
Repeat if necessary.
Yeah.
Be very clear. And I know it because I've run the nomination process when I was chairman of a party. And what candidates want is information and clarity. Yeah. And that is where the IBC is. So do voters as well. Voters want that as well. So Chebukati and Chiloba, the two chiefs, need to be every day with a briefing, addressing an issue, exhausting it, talking, not sitting
as under the towers, are being raised by politicians,
going to Kisumu, going to Mandera, it doesn't help. You know, testing these kids, showing, you know, you must build confidence.
Jonathan, to what extent do you think prior comments by, for example, Jubilee on issues raised on IBC are jeopardizing the confidence of the opposition? Every time the opposition raises an issue, the first people to respond are normally Jubilee.
And that's where you begin to smell a rat. By the way, I agree with my panelists today. I agree with my panelists today. the issues are really not there. The problem is communication.
Yes.
Yeah. And a lot of these issues can be addressed, but what we do is we politicize them.
Exactly.
Right? So when all of a sudden NASA says, wait a minute, IEBC, why do you want to have a central place to go and announce your results for the presidency while the law says this? Then you see a Jubilee politician tomorrow go address it somewhere in some point of the country. So ourselves as the opposition and all our supporters begin to think, wait a minute, maybe IEBC and Jubilee are the same person. You begin suspecting. Then Machangi comes into office. The first thing that he does, he calls Chebukati and Chiloba into his office to give them instructions and I don't know what. Then we are like, okay, wait a minute. This IEBC,
maybe they are just consulting.
Maybe they are consulting. But it's that perception that's been created. Yeah. IEBC is an independent
organization.
If anything, the CS Matiang'i should have gone to anniversary.
Yes. Now we appreciate the CS Matiang'i.
Is it under the police force?
No, hold on. Just let me explain my thoughts. Yes. CS Matiang'i is the acting internal security minister. He's a government official. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, this now goes to the law that we talk about here, the Public Officers and Ethics Act.
Yes.
That talks about these public officers not being involved in politics. Now we see Matiang'i campaigning for Jubilee in Nyamira and in Kisii.
Mm-hmm.
Now the same Matiang'i comes to Nairobi, puts on another coat and says, now I'm government, IEBC come, how can I support you? Of course the country is going to go wild.
Where is the line?
No.
I don't want to talk
about the line. Because
wait.
Uh-huh. Whether it was NASA in power or whether they would have done the same. So let us not lie.
But it's wrong.
Let's give the lady time, gentlemen.
I think it's not wrong. Because one, he's an individual. When he was in Nyamira, at that time he was Matiang'i. Now he's now an act. He has now known he's entered into acting. Let us finish first. Before, Kaiseri was there. He was doing his work. The late Kaiseri, isn't it?
Yeah.
Matiang'i was doing his work. So right now, I think Matiang'i now has realized, I have entered into a position where I need now to put myself and understand Kenyans are looking at the police force, the security, to ensure they work in collaboration with IEBC to have a peaceful
election.
And for him,
where is the line between Matiang'i?
That's what I'm saying. Before, he did not know. But now he's now an acting CS of security. He knows he has to have a line of understanding that he will be more involved in what we are saying, our elections, than before when he was just in education. He has to understand
he has seen the light.
And number two,
from soul to port.
What if Chebukati can just come out and decide for the next 2 weeks, I will brief Kenyans. All these things will turn. We will not even see Matiang'i in this picture. We will not see media wondering what to say.
There's
a vacuum. He needs to come in and just from now on brief Kenyans. So far we saw ballot papers of, governors. He needed to have told Kenyans why this has arrived early. It's because we have many and we are going to do it. Just the way he said, after every 2 days, we shall be having ballot papers coming in. Brief Kenya on all these issues that are happening.
You know, this country is 50 something years old.
54.
Actually, if it was a human being in civil service, you would have in 5 years.
You would retire.
You'd be old and tired.
I hope I'm not trying to retire. You see, there are certain standards that we are putting on ourselves that are really fake. Number one, Kenya's favorite sport is not athletics or football, it is politics. Kenyans in the villages before, you know, steamer went to all these areas would stay in the center until 7 o'clock news. Once they watched it, then they go to their villages.
Now even in the pubs today, at 7 o'clock, you have to switch off the news.
Mziki, you watch news. So Kenyans are very political. In the last election, for instance, the Minister of Interior then was Dodge Saitoti, wasn't he? He was a presidential candidate. Before he passed
away?
Then it became Kato Olomotito. Before that was a presidential candidate called Saitoti.
Yeah.
After Saitoti passed on, it was a candidate for Kajiado South called Olomotito.
And our history has been like that. When you try to separate a Kenyan, and I think, yes, the law says that, the Public Officer Ethics Act, you see, but I think we're putting standards that we cannot achieve.
Perception.
We're putting standards that are impossible to
achieve. I'm asking about perception. And he gave an example.
Yeah.
Today, Mheshimiwa Matiang'i is outlining the successes of Jubilee in Nyamira.
First.
Tomorrow morning,
first of all, issuing a press conference. First of all, I don't think there's anything wrong with any cabinet secretary.
No, I didn't say there's anything
wrong. I mean, it is their work. They must do it. They must be accountable to the public. Article 45, access to information. They must tell Kenyans what they have been doing. That is accountability. But I'm saying the expectation that once somebody is a public officer, that then they have no political thoughts. Is a high bar we have set for ourselves. Yes, it should not be done based on our current legal context, but it's a bar that I think we need to review moving forward.
Senator Mudla Kilonzo Jr. is banning.
It's not practical.
Absolutely. You know, even there was a reason, there was a rhyme and reason for making sure that our CSs are political. It's for purposes like this one, so that when Matiang'i stands, you see a technocrat as opposed to a politician, a Jubilee, almost sycophant. The point I'm making is this, that in the portion where he has, so that he looks as if he has come into office, you know, he's suffering from the point that he must look as if he's working.
But he's working.
What is it about security that concerns government and Jubilee that doesn't concern court? We are also concerned about security.
During an election.
So it's a matter that is across the board. So what do you do? You don't call those people into the office because themselves are the ones who leaked that they were summoned. It is them who leaked that information.
This is what summoned.
It was summoned because when you go to OP, what were you invited to do? Not for a cup of tea. You are just summoned by the minister. You know, because he wants to show you.
I think semantics. Yeah.
But let me explain. If you want to deal with a matter that then doesn't degenerate into this sort of discussion, Matiang'i should have sat with all stakeholders, sit in a meeting and say, how are we going to handle the question of security? Because this is not a matter that concerns them alone.
And agree with the stakeholders that from now on we'll be consulting more with IEBC.
You just say that we have deployed X number of officers for X. So that then both in Jubilee and court should go out to the public and tell the public. No wonder the statements this weekend about people not leaving. You go and say, we have enough security for you.
Don't leave.
Don't leave Nairobi.
You see,
all of us should say, Charles. But when Matiang'i sits in his office alone and issues threats, everybody starts imagining you're going to have.
My last word on this.
I think it's
all right.
We're really debating about the suspicions that are unnecessary. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The only reason why somebody would say these are the 10 issues that are on everybody's mind.
Correct. It's just the way they are handled. Yeah.
No,
we do recognize that Matiang'i is acting. Security minister and IEBC need security, so they must work together.
True.
What would have been wrong with Matiang'i going into IEBC's office? They have their meeting, they discuss whatever their meeting they're discussing, then they have a press conference and they say, as a minister,
today we discussed with IEBC, security,
and we agreed ABCD. But why Julia is saying that IEBC leaked
The information,
you only leak something when it's secret. So we are asking, why is Matiang'i and IEBC having a secret meeting?
That's the point.
There is no secret.
Even
as we move to an election, number one, the responsibility to secure Kenyans will still lie with the government that is in place.
And the responsibility to assure Kenyans?
To assure Kenyans must lie with the IEBC. They will work together. I think when we now split hairs about the venue of the meeting and how it was called and how it was communicated, then those are the perception issues that must be
raised. Do you think that Chibukati and Chiloba should have had a press conference and briefed Kenyans?
On the meeting. Is it not necessarily? Because you see, there are many operational meetings. Maybe that meeting was just about a certain deployment. You get? They cannot brief Kenyans every 2 hours when they interact with the Ministry of Security. But in terms of the overall security plan, they must brief Kenyans. Mm-hmm. But there are those operational, you know, this has changed, this email has come in, we need to see him, there are this number of police officers, you promised us 400 and we only see 600. You cannot do a press conference on all of that. You know, so unfortunately, we don't trust each other as a country. So
that's quite yeah. You talked about propaganda.
Yeah, I was saying, let us not start now that propaganda saying Matiang'i had a secret meeting. He never had a secret meeting.
You imagine they arrested him.
It's like people were picked, put in a car, during
Kanye,
and
taken
to
OP.
No, second
floor, around the house.
Okay, let's give her time.
And after that meeting of Matiang'i and Chiloba, the next, and we are not talking about it, we only remembering the first meeting, he had a meeting of all the stakeholders again, with the same IEBC, and I'm not hearing anyone now talk about it.
Political party.
And the whole, no, it was with the security team and now IEBC. So I think the best, and that is why security is called secret security. Because of all the politics we've had, we want everything, even where your enemy will come and strike you tonight. You want to say our borders are like this and we have 10 police officers protecting Somalia on this side. I mean, really, Kenya.
Fair enough, I think we
have to also keep into a secret where it's for our own protection.
We have been led that this long enough, and in the cross talking, Johnson said something about we don't trust each other. In communication, whenever there is a vacuum of information, there is misinformation.
Which is why I'm asking the two chiefs, Chebukati and Chiloba, to have daily briefings with clarity on all of these issues.
Give information. Do you think the presidential candidates should come out and give Kenyans information today in the debate?
Of course.
I start with you, John.
Information on what?
On what they plan to do, what they have done?
Yes, yes, absolutely. And I think it's extremely important because sometimes as Kenyans, and here I want to concur with my sister, Senator Elachi, as Kenyans, sometimes we take positions based on perception, positions based on feeling instead of logic. So what debates are supposed to do is they're supposed to bring out the real person, and that's why the viewers are usually highest during the debates, so that like Senator Elachi, when she had a town hall meeting the other day, was able to turn over one voter who thought she was a kind of person, but when she really interacted with them, he found out she was different. This is what the debates are supposed to do. So what I expect to see in today's debates is really a focus on issues instead of the personalities, and issues that affect the daily lives of Kenyans. Right now we are in a point where unemployment has reached almost the highest, corruption is almost at the highest levels we've ever had in this country, the significant insecurity, and we're going into a poll 14 days where Kenyans don't have much confidence within IEBC. So we expect the leading presidential candidates really come out very clearly on what it is they're going to do in the next 5 years that's going to affect the lives of the common Mwananchi. So that Mwananchi can make an informed decision and not say, I'm voting for this person because of this tribe, or this person because of this party, but I'm voting for this person because of what that person can do for me.
Fair enough,
as a person.
The presidential debate.
First, thank the media, and I believe if we deal with issues, if we focus on what is happening in our country without focusing on the president who is Uhuru Kikuyu, on our former prime minister who is Luo, if we don't go tribal and start bringing in the individualistic of each, we will have a fantastic debate. But the moment whoever will be their presenter and whoever moderator, you focus and start becoming
biased.
You bias and you want to bring out the individual person. Don't forget, both of them have a backyard. Their people will always feel very emotional, and you'll find the debate completely losing focus.
I think presidential debates and for candidates, you know, a step forward in our democracy. They gave JFK the victory. If you look at the history of how many American presidents have been made, because
by
debates and all that. However, I think there's a certain attitude that the media had taken. You know, that was just, for instance, I was at a debate last week, and I got the email about it like the day before. Mm-hmm. You know. And of course, I had issues with some of the things, like, why? How do you just bring that up? Why do you want to talk about issues that are not relevant to Nairobi, and we're able to have a discussion. I think what is important when you prepare debates, you need to have very close interaction with the different teams, you know, and you need to have, you know, for instance, even in the US, the different parties sit down and agree on the moderator. They say, okay, we know this person is unbiased, and we all agree on the moderator. We agree on the scope.
How is it a growing environment?
It's growing.
In the US, the Presidential Debate Commission is a legal entity.
I think we need to move there.
So we are moving.
But even if it's not legal, because you don't do things just because the law says it, you know, you didn't choose that tie because there's a law that says it. You say the tie that looks good today. I think it's
common. Oh, thank you.
Yeah, it's very nice actually, and I like the color. But I think it's common courtesy. For that to have been a better interaction between the Jubilee team and the NASA team, because I know what they wanted was to have a session where it's just His Excellency the President and the Right Honorable former Prime Minister, for them to agree on those issues that are unresolved, because there's a lot of mistrust.
But all in all, it should go on.
I think it's prudent. If those formatting issues are resolved, it should go on.
Thank you.
If those formatting issues are not resolved, you know what happened last time when you had only one guy at the Deputy President's debate. You know,
no, we had seven guys, and
actually
wanted to show up,
but they didn't show up. You can't say they wanted to show up, but there's a category where there's only one person who rolls podiums, you know. And it's because of this assumption by the media that if I call you tomorrow, you must be at this time, you must attend, you know. And the media has been bullying people, I think Kenyans would want to hear from the leaders what they have
for the sake of Kenyans, whether the media has been bullying or not. This is important.
I think the issues, and today we have time, and I want to tell you, to resolve those unresolved issues of formatting and whatnot.
Yeah.
If they're not resolved, you will not see the president.
Thank you.
The debate is critical to the extent that not much of what they are going to say today, but the fact that what they say today, they're going to be held to account several years to come. So that they can articulate those issues. But it should be a debate. Sometimes the moderators, the questions they ask are just off-tangent. There should be a moderation. The audience should be people who... The other day I watched a debate, I ended up switching it off because people were clapping, cheering, jeering, etc. That's not a debate. That's not a debate. Because then the person, the candidate...
Distraction.
The candidates have brought their own people before the fellow from afar complete the sentence in the Bible. People are clapping, and I'm wondering why they are clapping. So they must be able to allow them time to articulate the issues. I would prefer if they start with the candidates in advance. The way you sit with us, you call us to these interviews, you tell us in advance, your producers tell us in advance, so that we also prepare our minds, prepare our notes, so that then you can have a debate. I watched one of the debates, Nairobi debates. It actually generated into something that it was. It was a terrible debate. Nairobi.
Fair enough.
Was terrible.
I really want to thank
panel. But what happened to people like John Sibi Okumu? You know, people who anyone would accept, okay, that's a debate.
The problem is you look at the name first.
But even, I mean, people from either part of the country knew he's somebody who had distinguished himself as an unbiased media practitioner. And a couple like yourself, you know.
Maybe once we have a
unbiased.
Maybe once we have a commission,
who look unbiased. You know. But then we could never know. On his Twitter, he's hitting Jubilee, or hitting us on his Twitter.
All right.
And he's a moderator.
All right. You have made your point. That's just about all we had this morning. We once again apologize for the technical interruption earlier on in the show, but I had a fantastic panel here. Senator Mutula Kilonzo Jr., Mheshimiwa Johnson Sakaja, Senate candidate. Mheshimiwa Beatrice Bellache, and of course, Mheshimiwa Jonathan Mweke, Deputy Governor, Nairobi.
Thank you.
Can I make a request, gentlemen and lady? Please go and plant a tree when you leave here.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. Take it away, Carlos, on the band.
A tree.
A tree.